No.
Good morning, Maplewood, and welcome for those who are joining us. Praise God for whom all blessings come from.
Praise God from whom all blessings come.
Praise God.
Amen. Some of the fun of some of the new songs is they've taken some of the songs we love and brought them with a little bit of a new twist, but also bring all of those emotions for me of the first time I ever heard the song or all of the hundreds of times we sang that as an offertory. Welcome to worship at Maplewood United Methodist Church. We are so glad you're here, whether you're in person with us, whether you're online. Our goal is to make this to be a place where you feel loved and accepted. And some of that I know right now is all about masks. And our rule here is if you want to wear one, please do. If you don't, okay. We just ask that we respect and love each other in that space and not get in a battle about them, but to give each other that space to also feel safe in this time. And some of those ways that we do that are just being present and still continuing to help you be present online. Also aware that some of you probably are on the same schedule I prefer and watch this at 11 o'clock at night as opposed to in the morning. We're glad that we're able to bring the Word of God, the music that uplifts our souls, and to connect in whatever way you're able to connect. As we gather for worship this morning, I'm going to be talking about this, why we wait, thinking about waiting. And I don't know about you, but this season has always felt like hurry up and wait, and then wait some more, and then wait some more. But there are also a lot of other times in our lives where we have to wait. Wait to get to graduate, wait until we find out what their doctor really means by that thing they just said and passing as they walked out the door. Wait to hear, wait for something. And I want to invite you into this place where Christ invites us, yes, to wait. But he says, here's the thing. As you wait, remember you have hope. Remember that no matter what we're waiting for or how long we're waiting as people who have hope because our Lord and Savior was resurrected from the dead. I invite you to stand and worship with us. Whether you sing or not, that is entirely up to you. You can wave your hands or stomp your feet.
Let us sing praises to God, our good Father, who always is with us and loves us for who we are.
may be seated. As we enter into this time of prayer, I invite you, if you would like to put a prayer concern on the prayer wall in our app. You can put it on for this morning for me to lift up if all technology works perfectly. It allows us, for those that are watching, you can also join. And if you're watching later, please put those prayer concerns on that wall, because we will indeed share them next Sunday. So know that that is available to you even in the middle of the week if you want to. In addition to that, some of the ones that have been lifted up to me already this morning, I think, I have to say I shut off the news, but just for a couple days. But I do believe that we need to keep in prayer those that were shot at the supermarket, and just the continued havoc, all of that, and pain that is happening, to continue to keep in prayer the families that are losing someone to COVID or to any of the other ways that people are suffering through this time. We want to lift up Sue Anderson, who's had a pretty tough week. She's been on our prayer wall for a lot of situations, so I just lift her up and surround her and her family with all the strength and courage they need. We're going to start praying now for Dominic's dad, who's going to be having a pacemaker put in the first part of October, so we just want to keep him in our prayers that that all goes well as so many of the others. So this is what I mean by technology. It always works perfectly. So those are our prayer concerns. Let us be in the spirit of prayer. Holy and gracious God, we gather as those who are waiting for your return, who wish for the world to be a better, more peaceful place, where indeed people know the abundance of your love, but also the care of a neighbor, the appreciation of a friend. We gather as those who also call, O God, that you help us be transformed, that you fill us with love, that we might live out of that abundance, remembering that your message to us was one of hope, one of transformation, one of peace. As we come together, O God, we do indeed lift up those in our hearts, whether they're situations like yet another shooting, or the wars around the world, or the refugees who are trying to find a place that is safe without fear of violence and loss of life. Whether it is indeed our neighbors who just need enough food to feed their family. Holy God, we are here to call out to you. For those that have had surgeries this week, for those that are facing surgeries in the weeks to come, we put them in your hands. Help them to have that peace in their hearts, remembering that they have hope because they have you. Help us, O God, to indeed live out that message of hope, celebrating and remembering, living our lives as an example of what it means to believe in your resurrection and our new life. We ask this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
As we prepare to hear today's message, let us remember, as the song says, all who are thirsty, all who are weak, are welcome.
If your heart is
So the passage for this morning comes from Luke chapter 24, verses 36 through 53, and it really isn't as long as that sounds. But this is part of the liminal time kind of passages that I've been looking at for the last year. Some of what happened with the pandemic, something happened with the changing of a pastor just before that happened, something happened with so many different places where the world just shifted. And we were thrown in the liminal space, which was that space, you can think of it as the threshold of a door, that space when what used to be has ended and what is going to be hasn't yet started. And we as human beings have a hard time in that place. What was amazing to me was when I started looking at scripture and saying, deal with liminal time, was there such a thing? So many passages of space in between. And one we're really familiar with is this time after Christ has died and they found the empty tomb and he's been resurrected and the church essentially starting. And that's, we find the disciples in the upper room gathered. We find them in a room gathered and the disciples who just met Jesus on the walk to Emmaus have just come back. While the two followers were telling this, Jesus himself stood right in the middle of them and said, "Peace be with you." They were fearful and terrified and thought they were seeing a ghost. But Jesus said, "Why are you troubled? Why do you doubt what you see? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. Because a ghost does not have living body, as you see I have." After Jesus said that, he showed them his hands and feet, while they still could not believe it because they were amazed and happy. Jesus said to them, "Do you have any food here?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish. While the followers watched, Jesus took the fish and ate it. He said to them, "Remember when I was with you before, I said that everything written about me must happen, everything in the law of Moses, the books of the prophets, and the Psalms." Then Jesus opened their minds so they could understand the scriptures, and he said to them, "It is written that the Christ would suffer and rise from the dead, and on the third day, that a change of hearts and lives and forgiveness of sins would be preached in his name to all nations, starting in Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I will send you what my Father has promised, but you must stay in Jerusalem until you have received that power from heaven." Jesus led his followers as far as Bethany, and he raised his hands and he blessed them. While he was blessing them, he was separated from them and carried into heaven. They worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem very happy. They stayed in the temple all the time, praising God. May God bless the reading and hearing of his word. Now, I do have to tell you that when I started and chose this passage, the waiting that I expected to be talking about was the waiting after Jesus sent them to Jerusalem to sit and wait for the power of the Holy Spirit. But one of the things that happened as I look closer at the passage is that there were two times in this passage where people were waiting. The first were the disciples who were huddled in fearful and terrified and uncertain about the future. They gathered and waited. They didn't know what they were waiting for. They didn't know if anything would come. They just were lost and afraid. And they were doubting this resurrection. They'd been told about the empty tomb. They'd heard just then, again, from two followers who had seen him raised and walked with them and ate with them. And yet, they weren't really sure. And then we see the second waiting, which is after Jesus has come and revealed to them that, again, this is real. Who is the God that we believe in? He is really resurrected from the dead. That's the God we believe in. And these people go to wait, and what are they? They're happy and rejoicing, and they go to worship every day. They are still waiting, but they're waiting with hope, with an understanding and a belief that they have something to look forward to instead of just loss and pain. I think a key piece in this story is this piece of Christ revealing himself. He comes and stands among them, and I always love the phrase, I will always love it, peace be with you. He doesn't come in and say, hey, y'all ran away. He doesn't come in and say, you now have to do all of these things because I'm leaving it to you. He doesn't come in with a message of dread or judgment. He doesn't come in hard. He comes in with a message of peace be with you. Which essentially, which we've forgotten in the whole passing of the peace, but it is, you are forgiven. Think about that into this crowd that's doubting, into this crowd is unsure, not feels like they didn't get the message at all, to Peter, who denied Jesus 3 times, to all of the disciples who ran and hid the whole time, worried about themselves instead of what was happening to Christ. Jesus steps into that room and says, peace be with you. You are forgiven. To me, it sets the tone for everything to hear from that point on. Everything to hear before that is this understanding that Christ did not come into the world to cause us pain or suffering, to give us a hard time, or to tell us everything we were doing wrong. Christ came into the world to bring peace. But not only in this passage does he come and say, peace be with you, he also says, look, I'm real. I'm not a ghost. I'm real. My body was really resurrected. See the scars. Touch me. And even more, he says, give me something to eat. And he eats it. Why is that important? Because this message of hope isn't just that we'll get to go to heaven when we're dead. The message of hope that Christ brings to us is a message for hope for now, too. We're not all just waiting to get to heaven when things will be good. That isn't the story. The story is that if we live in Christ and we wait on him to lead us and we continue to worship and follow in his footsteps, then we make the world better. And we can live in hope instead of fear. We see these two pictures. A picture of fear is the, I don't know what to do. It's all falling apart. To the happiness and joy of the world isn't perfect yet, but we have hope in Christ. Not just for our life in heaven, but for our life right here, right now. And it's important in that same sense as we talked about last week of this sense of who is the God we believe in. He's saying, it isn't just about your spirit. This is about you in your body right now. When I think about all of this time through the pandemic, it's not been a struggle of, do I believe God will heal me magically or protect me from something that will come at me? It's about this challenge of living, do I live with fear in my heart or live with hope? And putting on a mask doesn't mean I'm afraid, because that falls under our other Wesleyan principle of do no harm. The care about your neighbor and do all that you can. But putting on a mask can either be done thinking, I have no idea if I have control, or it can be put on going, I know that I have hope in Christ no matter what happens today. And Christ is saying to his disciples, here's the thing, I'm giving you hope. You have hope in a life now, hope in a life in the future, hope in God's love and God's peace. That's who we're called to be. And I have to tell you, one of our biggest struggles in life is to wait, right? Sitting still is hard. Do you want me to test you? But through this time, one of the things that's become abundantly aware to me, at the beginning it was, hurry up, you got to do something. Actually, first was, just wait, in 2 weeks this will be over. And we were all okay with that, weren't we? Once it went past that, and it was the, we have no idea when this is going to end or what's coming next, you've got to figure it out, I found myself so many times trying to rush ahead, trying to figure out the answers, trying to solve the problems. And, you know, I can't even tell you how many times it didn't work. Because everything changed. We all knew it. All you had to do is turn on the news at noon and at 5, and we were in a different place within that short period of time. Rushing ahead doesn't necessarily give us the answers. And sometimes all of those plans I had made to deal with a situation that was in the present had to be thrown out, and we had to start all over again. I don't know if you've ever had to do that in your lifetime. It could be for weddings or for any other things. Some of what I started to learn was how important it is to slow down and relax, because it isn't about me fixing the problem. I can neither guarantee everybody's safety nor figure out what tomorrow will bring entirely. But I can be present in the moment. I can be fully present in the moment. I can trust and believe in the hope that I have that we'll solve tomorrow's problems when they come, that God will be with us when we get there. And to me, that becomes this piece of, why do we wait? We wait because it's not about us. That seems like a hard thing for us to get. It's a hard thing for me to get. It isn't about me fixing it. In our life as believers, it's about waiting and letting God change us. Now, that isn't the same as sitting perfectly still, is it? Because what I love about these disciples in this story, Luke says, yes, they go on to Jerusalem, but they don't sit in the room going, so what's going to happen next? They happily go to the temple and worship every day. They live into that hope. They remember in every moment of every day that their hope is not in what they do, but in what God does. Their hope lived in that gift that God was going to give them. And if we look at the story further than this, we know that that's the disciples have to learn. They keep trying to take control, just like we do. They keep trying to say, this is the direction we're going. And the Holy Spirit goes, yeah, no, this is the direction we're going. But in this moment of waiting and being faithful, they start to know the feeling of the difference between, I've got to fix this, and the, it'll be okay. God's with us. They learn the difference between the things that they thought they knew and trusting to step out into those places where they didn't know what was going to happen. So why do we dare wait in a liminal space? The first is, how many of you think you have all the answers? When we don't, rushing ahead means forgetting that Christ is where our hope is. Staying together, being fully present with each other, and listening for God's word, and moving when He says, move. changes us from people who think we're in control to those who know the real hope of a really risen Christ. Will you pray with me? Holy and gracious God, in your love for us, you keep giving us the space. You keep asking us to be fully present. So help us, O God, to fill our hearts, to listen, but in all our ways, to worship you. In Jesus' name, amen. Some of our caution that I'm going to say, because there's a whole lot of stuff to do in October. You can be here every day you want in October. But I invite you to come not as somebody who's coming to do, but as somebody who's coming to be present. Whether that's to come and help with the soup fundraiser, or to come to the casserole dinner, or to come to one of the meetings where we're going to talk about what it looks like to moving forward, I invite you to come and be present as we listen for what God is telling us in this season as a church. I also invite you, as always, to participate, because we can't hear God's voice if we don't try to listen to it. And those are where the Bible studies come in, whether it's the hymn study, the book study, or the Gospel of John study, to know that you're able to participate in most of those, either virtually or in person. We're going to keep working on your tech skills. That's all I can tell you. Also, there's just those ways in which we show love to our neighborhood, which is who we are as Maplewood. And one of those ways is that we do the parent-teacher night meal for the teachers over to Laura Dodge across the street. And Linda Johnson is collecting money to be able to put those meals together. So if you're willing to give a donation there, please do. I'm also kind of stepping up. Last year, I got a list of teachers and we divided it up and sent cards throughout the school year just to make sure they got a "we're with you" kind of message throughout the year. There were a couple teachers changes, but I have not gotten an accurate list yet. So I thought I would send a basket of maybe candy, cookies, gum, gift cards. I'm told teachers love gift cards. I got a yes. So if you would like to donate anything to put into that basket, I think I'm going to aim for like a Halloween basket. And if anybody's really crafty and you want to tell me how to make a basket that looks pretty, I'm up for that. So please remember to step into our relationship, that we know that we have hope with Christ. As we close today, the song that I invite you to stand and worship to is "Forever." And it's, no matter why we wait, we want to remember that God's love endures forever, that hope never goes away. Please stand and worship.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God and King. His love endures forever, for he is good. Forever, for the life that's been renewed.
God bless you all, every day, every moment. May you know the hope of Christ in your hearts. May you know his love. Go in peace.